بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله تبارك وتعالى نحمده ونستعين به ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله تعالى، وخير الهدي هدي محمد عليه الصلاة والسلام، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار، وما قل ودل خير مما كثر وألهى، وقليل يغنيك خير من كثير يطغيك، وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. وبعد، dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, inshallah ta'ala, tonight we're going to cover ayah number 5 in Surah Al-Ahzab. And as I said today in the khutbah, that ayah number 5 is connected to ayah number 4. And today in ayah number 4, we saw how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us that Islam actually doesn't have to agree with our culture, and it doesn't have to be against our culture either. Like when Islam came, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala approved subhanahu wa ta'ala some of the Arab cultures. Like for example, the Arabs are so generous, and they are known as generous people until today. It is something that's rooted inside of them. So when Islam came, he didn't go against this culture. He actually praised Arabs, and I mean, he praised generosity, and he approved this. The Arabs, for example, they have غَيْرَ لِلْنِسَاء. غَيْرَ لِلْنِسَاء, you know, most of the Arabs, if he sees a man talking to his wife, he would be boiling inside. He doesn't like that. He feels like so jealous. It is something rooted inside of us as Arabs. And that's something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala liked, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam liked, and Islam praised. To feel jealous towards your family, to be protective of your family. But sometimes we had also some habits among the Arabs or among people in general before Islam, that when Islam came, didn't like actually, and Islam tried to stop these habits. Like today we mentioned two of them, as I said, in ayah number 4, al-zihar wa al-tabanni. And as for al-zihar, I explained today briefly in the khutbah that al-zihar is when a man fights with his wife and he tries to punish her by saying anti alayya ka dhahri ummi. So he used the word dhahr. Dhahr means back. You are to me like the back of my mother. It means you are unlawful for me. I'm not going to touch you anymore. And it's a kind of injustice towards women, obviously. Because he didn't say anti taliq. He didn't say I divorce you. You know, if he said I divorce you, okay, now she knows what she's going to do. She has to say for the idda first, and then she is going to marry somebody else. She knows that she's divorced. And if you don't say anything, okay, we'll just fight and tomorrow we reconcile and it's okay. Because this is life. But when he says to her, anti alayya ka dhahri ummi, this dhihar, she doesn't know actually where she should go. She's not married, and she's not divorced either. And when this woman came to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, Khawla bint Tha'laba, and after she presented her case to Rasulullah, and she was complaining, Rasulullah at the beginning said, I haven't received any Quran regarding your case. And then when the Quran was revealed, he said, Abshiri, فَقَدْ أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ فِيكِ قُرْآنًا. Abshiri means Allah is defending you. I'm giving you bushra. I'm giving you glad news. Allah has revealed the Quran in your regard. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Qad Sama', and this is the part that I didn't mention today about the kafara, expiation. If somebody says to his wife as a punishment, he wants to harm her, أَنْتِ عَلَيْكَ ظَهْرُ أُمِّي, what is he supposed to do? قال الله الذين يظاهرون منكم من نسائهم ثم يعودون لما قالوا فتحرير رقبة من قبل أن يتماسا. Allah is saying, you know, I created you. I know that sometimes when you're angry, you say some stuff and then you regret that later. When you reconcile, you say, I shouldn't have said that actually. You regret a lot of what you do when you're angry. So Allah is saying here, if you want to repent, if you want to go back to your wife and live with her a normal life, the expiation, the kafara is one, to free a slave, which is not easy on Arabs. Because having a slave is something like it's a wealth that you have. Somebody's serving you. A slave, you can just move him wherever you want. He's your slave, you own him, literally. But because Islam came to end that slavery, Islam was looking forward to stop slavery, not start slavery. So Allah said, if you want to go back to your wife, you can just free a slave. But if you can't, because you don't have slaves, for example, فَتَحْرِيرُ رَقَبَةٍ مِّن قَبْلَ يَتَمَسَّ ذَلِكُمْ تُوَعَظُونَ بِهِ وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ فَمَن لَّمْ يَجِدْ, if you don't have a raqaba, if you don't have a slave, فَصِيَامُ شَهْرَيْنِ مُتَتَابِعَيْنِ مِّن قَبْلِ أَن يَتَمَسَّ, before you touch your wife, even before you touch her, because you're trying to harm her from the beginning, Allah is the one who is defending her now. Allah is the one who is stopping the husband now. Nobody can stop him, this guy. You know, sometimes when a brother comes to me, for example, when his wife has a problem, and he finds me in his wife's side, he stops coming to me, khalas. Oh, this imam is not with me. And he thinks when he comes to me, I have to be in his side. No, I don't have to. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wasn't in the men's side all the time. Sometimes the men are wrong. The man is wrong. The husbands are wrong sometimes. So Allah is saying here, before you touch her, if you already regret what you did, before you touch her, you need to fast 2 months. 2 months as an expiation for what you did. طيب فمن لم يجد فإطعام 60 مسكين. If you cannot fast because you're not strong enough, you need to feed 60 needy, 60 people who are needy, as an expiation because you were unjust towards your wife. Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doing all this? Because Islam wants to establish justice. Not because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always in the women's side. Not because I'm a feminist and I want to tell you, oh, we care about women's life for any reason to please some people. Not to do that. I'm just reciting some ayat, and then I'm giving you a very brief translation, actually. I'm not going into any details. I'm only reciting some ayat from the Quran and giving you the meaning, the rough translation of the ayat. And from just the translation, if you go by yourself to Surah Al-Mujadala, you will see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was on the woman's side. Because the man tried to harm her by saying, "Anti alayya kadhar ummi," you're not divorced and you're not married either. You cannot marry and I'm not married to you. You can stay like this for 1, 2, 3, 4 years, and then whenever I want to bring you to my house, I bring you back. Allah doesn't like that. Allah doesn't accept that. That's injustice. So that's the first habit that Islam came to stop. Al-dhihar. You might say, we don't have dhihar nowadays. Nobody uses this word nowadays. You don't have to use this word. If somebody tries to harm his wife in any way, shape, or form, Allah is against him. Allah is against, not him, because he cannot be against Allah. Allah is against that action. Allah doesn't like that. Yib al-dhihar. Number two, at-tabanni. Our adopted son, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us here in ayah number 5. Because it is connected to ayah number 4. Qala, udu'uhum li'aba'ihim huwa aqsatu 'inda Allah. If you want to adopt a child, that's actually recommended. Do it. He's an orphan. You're taking care of an orphan. You're keeping him in your house. Amazing. Unless you have some maharim, like you have your wife, you have your daughters, and he cannot live with them, be very careful. But Allah is saying, do not give him your name. Do not give him your name. And we said before that the first one who did that was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And because of that, because of the fact that Rasulullah is the one who gave Zayd ibn Haritha his name, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was talking in this ayah so nicely. Because who did that? His beloved, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you will see now how Allah talked to him. He's teaching us a lesson through him, alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. قَالَ أُدْعُوهُمْ لِآبَائِهِمْ let your adopted children keep their parents' names. Don't give them your names. أُدْعُوهُمْ لِآبَائِهِمْ هُوَ أَقْسَطُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ That's actually more just in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we will now recite some ahadith to know how haram it is to give someone your name, even if he is your adopted son. I will recite unto you only two ahadith here. Al-Imam Al-Qurtubi, rahimahullah ta'ala, in his tafsir, narrated this hadith عن سعد بن أبي وقاص رضي الله عنه وأبي بكرة not أبو بكر صديق الصحابي whose kunya is أبو بكرة كلاهما قال سمعته أذناي ووعاه قلبي these two صحابة they said we have heard Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم with our ears and we really understood what he said. You know when somebody says to you, I heard him with my ear. I know you don't hear somebody with your nose. You hear with your ear. But they are trying to emphasize that it's actually it happened. You try to emphasize something. I hit him with my hand. Really? Not with your nose? No, you want to emphasize it. So these two Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they really want to tell us, look, I really heard Rasulullah saying this. There's no doubt about that. قال أن I understood it ووعاه قلبي قال both of them said قال رسول الله من ادعي إلى غير أبيه whoever keeps a name of a man other than his father like an adopted child who has a name other than the name of his father وهو يعلم أنه غير أبيه while he knows that he's not his real father. He doesn't know his real father. He knows he's not my real father, but I'm taking his name. You know what he said, as-salam? قَالَ فَالْجَنَّةُ عَلَيْهِ حَرَامٌ For him, it's a haram to enter Jannah. Like he's deprived of getting into Jannah just because of this. So don't give anybody... You don't do that, by the way. If somebody does this, it's a haram, right? وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن أبي ذر ليس من رجل ادعي لغير أبيه وهو يعلم إلا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said if anybody keeps a name of a man other than his father and he considers that name as his father's name فقد كفر he has committed an act of disbelief of course it's not a major kufr he's not non-Muslim now Because we have shirkun akbar and shirkun asghar. Kufrun akbar and kufrun asghar. Fisqun akbar and fisqun asghar. Nifaqun, zulmun akbar wa asghar. We have said this before many times. When you read the word kufr or shirk in the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or in the Quran, it does not mean every single time disbelief as being out of Islam. But it's an act of disbelief. It's a major sin in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See how dangerous that is. Who did that before he said this ahadith sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Before this ayat were revealed on him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He did that. Sayyidah Khadija radiallahu anha, she had a servant whose name is Zayd ibn Haritha. And she gifted him to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Gave him as a gift to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So people used to call him Zayd ibn Muhammad. And as I told you, they didn't have documents. There's no official papers. So after some time, he's going to be considered as one of Ahlul Bayt. As one of Ahlul Bayt. And he's going to take from the inheritance of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam if he has something, alayhi salatu wasalam, to distribute after his death. Right? So it's and if he dies first, Rasulullah can inherit him. That's so dangerous. So in this ayat was revealed, And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam called Zayd ibn Haritha and said to him, From today, you are Zayd ibn Haritha, you're not Zayd ibn Muhammad anymore. Sallallahu alayhi wasalam. You're Zayd. Kana waqafan. Waqafan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he sees the stop sign, he stops. Not because he's going to take a ticket. Not because we're going to get a ticket. But because Allah said stop, you have to stop. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tayyib. But there's a problem here. Sometimes what happens back home, I don't know, I've never seen this here before, but you might have seen this here or have heard of this. Sometimes we find some babies next to some buildings and we don't know their parents. So if I don't know his parent, if I don't know his father, how should I give him his father's name? فقال الله عز وجل فإن لم تعلموا آباءهم فإخوانكم في الدين ومواليكم. If you don't have any idea who is his father, then they are simply your fellow believers and the close associates. Associates. Okay, they are your friends. They are your brothers in Islam. You call him my brother. So for example, if his name is Ahmed and you don't know his father, you have two options. So call him Ahmed ibn Abi, because I don't know his father. So is Ahmed the son of his father? Allah only knows his real father. And it's going to be embarrassing for him, right or wrong? Imagine if someone knows him with us and his name is Ahmed ibn Abi. So everybody knows that we don't know his dad. It's not good, right? It's very embarrassing for him, humiliating. So the other option you say, Ahmed ibn Abdullah, because everybody is Abdullah. All of us are the slaves of Allah, right? So if you call him Ahmed ibn Abdullah, خلاص, he's good now. Call him Ahmed ibn Abdullah, right? So you have two options here, Ahmed ibn Abi and Ahmed ibn Abdullah, right? So Islam also covered him. He is safe, right? طيب فإن لم تعلموا أباهم فإخوانكم في الدين وماليكم. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at that. Because I told you the one who did this is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah is giving us a lesson through him alayhi wa sallam. So when he goes through him, the way he subhanahu wa ta'ala talks in the ayah changes. It's a big mistake, right? We agree that whoever does this is an act of disbelief, right? We agreed that the Jannah is haram for him. But because Rasulullah is the one who did that, and he didn't know, and he stopped immediately when he knew alayhi wa sallam, Allah ended the ayah like this. وَلَيْسَ Beautiful. قَلْ وَلَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ جُنَاحٌ فِيمَا أَخْطَأْتُمْ بِهِ وَلَكِنْ مَا تَعَمَّدَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. Ya salam. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at the amount of love that Rasulullah is being showered with alayhi salatu wasalam. You don't have to worry. وَلَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ جُنَاحٌ فِي مَخْلَطُ بِيَا مُحَمَّدٍ. Allah is not going to question you if you do something by mistake. I know you did this by mistake. You didn't know. وَلَكِنْ مَا تَعَمَّدَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ. From now on, if you do this intentionally, now it's going to be a big haram. وَلَكِنْ مَا تَعَمَّدَتْ. Because now you know. Rasulullah hasha, he's not going to do that. Now it's for us now. The second statement is for us, not for him, as-salam. And then the last one, وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. خلاص, Allah has forgiven you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is all-forgiving and most merciful, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't have to worry, but be careful next time. Sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. So we have lots of lessons here that we can learn. One is Islam came to establish justice. Islam was never in men's side or women's side all the time. When somebody wrongs the other, Islam goes in his side, the side of the one who is being wronged. Two, Islam is not always against our culture or with our culture either. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometimes he approves some of our cultures, sometimes he does not. So when we tell you sometimes in some khutbahs or halaqat, you know, this is haram, and you have been doing this your whole life. I know some people don't like this, but you need to be waqaf as well, as Rasulullah was, alayhi salatu wasalam. Don't just go and twist the ayah and the hadith to agree with what I'm doing. No. You need to, if you want to follow this religion, you have to change to follow the ayah or to follow the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Jazakumullahu khayran. وأقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت. أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.